I decided to become a medical doctor in high school. My dad was a pharmacist, and so the plan was that I would go to medical school, I would come home, open an office across the street, and send him prescriptions. So that's initially where the idea came from. And I stuck to that idea during college, even though my interests were not particularly in the sciences, they were much more in the liberal arts. I was much more interested in history and philosophy than I was spending all afternoon in a lab while everybody was outside having fun. But I was too neurotic at that point to make the change, and so I went to medical school. I didn't like medical school much at all. I was most attracted to psychiatry. And so after medical school, Jean and I were married at that time, and we went to York, Pennsylvania, where it was a general rotating internship, and I became good friends with the psychiatrist on the staff, and he took me on some house calls, and I helped him, and I liked that. And so I made a decision that I was going to go into psychiatry, and I applied for a residency in Philadelphia and was accepted. And on the way back to Philadelphia, I said to Jean, well, I'll give it 1 year. If I don't like it, I'm going to law school. I loved it. And that was the start of the psychiatric story. How I got to psychoanalysis was I had some wonderful supervisors who were psychoanalysts. Indeed, almost the entire residency was of psychoanalysts who were teaching us. And that clearly indicated to me that there was a way of thinking about myself, about patients, and about life that was extraordinarily interesting. And that's when I decided to become a psychoanalyst. After a couple years in the United States Air Force, as a psychiatrist, I came back and finished my psychoanalytic training in Philadelphia, and with each passing year felt more and more fascinated by the mind and the psychoanalytic way of thinking about the mind. At that time, there was no such thing as adult development. Almost all of psychoanalysis was focused on childhood and the first 5 years of life. I wrote my graduation thesis from the Philadelphia Institute for Psychoanalysis on the idea of, well, what happens in adulthood to development? Very little people paid any attention to it, but my interest was stimulated, and that became my major interest. The developmental focus became central to me as a result of my child analytic training in Philadelphia. There again, all of my supervisors were adult and child analysts, and development and the idea of Freud's series on development made more sense to me than anything else. Before I left Philadelphia, I had the opportunity to present a case to Anna Freud that also stimulated my interest. And with that kind of a background, I moved to California in 1973. Once here, once I got established practice established, I became friends with another psychoanalyst, Robert Nemiroff, and he and I decided that we would attempt to write about development in the adult years, following up on the individuals who had preceded us, and that's how I got to the point of being focused on adult development. My first book was in 1981, but the first article was in the late 1970s. The article was about some basic principles and concepts about adult development. Yes, it was a strange concept to many analysts and to many psychiatrists as well. But I wouldn't say that anybody strongly opposed it. It was more, okay, that's interesting, but I don't think it means very much. So it was more that kind of an attitude. But gradually, as I wrote more and more, there was more and more interest. And for a period of time, adult development was very prominent in a lot of psychiatric and psychoanalytic thinking. I would say that it has become a part of the psychiatric and psychoanalytic landscape, but still many psychiatrists and psychoanalysts do not think developmentally. They say, and it may be correct for some of them, that they don't need to think developmentally. That, for instance, nowadays there's so much focus on intersubjectivity, on the relationship between the analyst and the patient, that becomes the dominant theme in practice, and people don't see the need for development. My own experience clinically is that understanding development throughout the life cycle helps you understand a patient of any age. Yeah. If you're dealing with a 50-year-old, you need to know about his early experiences in childhood and adolescence and young adulthood, and then what he's currently dealing with as a 50-year-old. And we can make the same sense for a patient of any age as we approach them. Anybody who walks into my office brings with them, even though they don't know it, a developmental frame. They have to be engaging the major developmental themes of that particular phase of development. And some patients are very aware of that, others are not at all. But I begin my relationship with them with that frame in the background, and then I listen to what they choose to present to me. And gradually, as I understand more and more, after working with them, I'm in a position eventually to interpret some aspects of their conflicts in terms of development. First, there has to be a foundation of a knowledge of development throughout the life cycle. You use that as a basis for your interaction with a patient of any age. And the resonance comes from the ability to understand that individual and where they are, and to empathize with them and be with them at their developmental level. And so it's a combination of knowledge, of understanding, and of empathy and experience in living. Well, aging begins at birth. That's one way to think about it. But from the standpoint of the aging process, I think that the forward push of development continues through adolescence and into the 20s. And in the late 20s and into the 30s, the aging process or physical retrogression begins to become prominent. Okay. Some individuals in their 30s lose their hair. By the time you're in your 30s, you're not as active physically. Your reflexes are not quite as good as they were. And so signs of aging become obvious. Women also begin to have more and more trouble conceiving in their 30s and into their 40s, although certainly science has expanded that now into the 40s for many women. So I would say the tipping point is somewhere in the late 20s into the 30s when the process begins. And then it continues for the rest of life from then on. How aging affects one's life depends on how you react to it. The individual who has maybe the insight or the understanding that they need to take care of their body is the individual who is likely to be wise in old age, because the mind resides in the body, and taking care of the body needs to begin in young adulthood and certainly become a prominent factor in middle adulthood, and should be a central theme in late adulthood. And it's been my personal experience and the experience of many others that those individuals who have cared for their body and continue to do so on a daily basis are much more likely to continue to live a full, active, physical, sexual, and psychological life well into late adulthood. First of all, the life cycle implying, as you said, a kind of a curve, that doesn't make any sense. What popped into my mind when you said that was Anna Freud's concept of developmental lines. But if we're going to use the analogy of a shape, I think more of a slow uphill climb, not a slow decline. And at each developmental phase, it can be a wonderful experience, well into late adulthood, if again, the body is in reasonable shape and you continue to take care of the mind as well as the body. Okay. I'm 82. I've never felt better physically or mentally in my life. But I've taken care of my body for a very long time. I work out 3 to 4 times a week. I play golf once or twice a week. I have physical activity every day. And mentally, because I did not retire and don't plan to, I find the work that I'm doing requires great mental concentration and effort. And I think that, more than anything, explains yes. why I feel as sharp as I do at 82. I've written a number of papers on time sense as it's experienced yes. throughout the life cycle. And every developmental phase has a different sense of time. Just summarizing in childhood, the time seems to be endless, and you look forward to getting older. In approximately the beginning of the 20s, the whole phase of development, childhood, is in the past, and so the past takes on a new meaning. In young adulthood, the sense of foolish invincibility seems still to be there, and people don't realize that their behavior can be very risky and can end their lives prematurely. When you get into midlife, you deal with the central task of midlife, which is understanding that there is a limitation to time and that you will die. And the gradual integration of that idea, which causes midlife transition in many people and the real thing, midlife crisis in some, as a reflection of the individual struggling consciously or unconsciously with that concept. Individuals in old age, late adulthood, and late adulthood still continue to process the idea of time limitation and of their own death. I think that the work that we do as psychiatrists and psychoanalysts is very helpful personally in that regard. I've not only dealt with the idea of my own mortality, but I've helped hundreds, maybe thousands of individuals to deal with the concept themselves in the therapeutic situation. And that has led to the point where I'm at 82. I feel full of life. I enjoy every day. I'm planning for the future. I know at some point that it will end. I don't know when. But I have fully integrated the idea that my life will end and that everything that I have and hold dear will come to an end. One of the things which that has led to recently is the realization that even though I'm working and making money, I'm no longer doing it for myself. I'm basically doing it for others. I'm doing it so that there's money to give to my wife's multiple charities. I'm doing it so that I can give in the present money to my children, grandchildren, and that we continue to help others around the world. That's basically where I'm at this point in the life cycle, and I don't feel old, although people treat me as though I'm old. For instance, our children, my wife's 83, I'm 82, they hover around us now, almost as though we're invalids, and we're not. We can still take care of ourselves, we're still independent and autonomous, but it's clearly a sign of love on their part, and we understand that, even though it's annoying. The foundation of wisdom is, one, understanding yourself at every point through the life cycle, and two, having lived and experienced many of the absolutely basic human experiences, such as relationships, such as love, not always necessary, but children, grandchildren, friends, a career, having traveled, having seen the world, understanding other cultures. All of these help you come to the realization that you are one of currently 7 or 8 billion people on the planet, that our circumstances may be somewhat different, our cultures may be somewhat different, but we're all basically the same. And that, I think, is an important element of wisdom. And that tempers narcissism. I may think I'm special, but I'm really not. I'm like every other human being. I experience what every other human being is experiencing, and I will die like every other human being. Well, I think our work gives us a great advantage because we learn about the human condition in depth. I think another aspect of it has to do with the kind of experiences that you've had in life. My wife and I both grew up in loving, intact families. We had our parents until we were in our 50s and they were in their 80s. So we lived the life cycle, in a sense, from early in childhood up to and including their deaths. And then we've been fortunate enough to have 25 and hopefully more years after their death to, in a sense, take their place, to be seen by our children and grandchildren as the elders in the family, fortunately the loved elders in our case. And so we have integrated the entire life experience, and I think that prepares you not only to understand the human condition, but to deal with and accept the physical end which will take place. My life revolves every day around classical music. I listen from the moment I get up until the moment I go to sleep. It gives me a greater sense of being human and of the very best aspects of humanity than anything else. But that's certainly not a universal experience, and nor is it even what most of my family members experience. Their music is very different than mine. I think I was born with a receptivity to classical music that allowed me from the time I was very little to resonate with it and experience. And some of the most sublime experiences I've had being alive is listening to various kinds of classical music. Mahler's symphonies come to mind. Strauss's Four Last Songs come to mind. I was just listening to the final trio from Der Rosenkavalier, which I think is the most glorious women's voices singing anywhere in the literature. Puccini's my favorite composer. When it comes to classical music, I love Wagner. I recently sat through the entire Ring cycle and was sad when the 22 hours of music were over. And I like almost all of it. And every day I have some kind of a very special sense of being alive when a particular piece resonates with me. I was a musician. At one point I used to play the piano fairly well, but as I got older and I got arthritis in my hands, I could no longer play well enough to satisfy myself, so I stopped. So now I listen to others who played much better than I ever did. Even though I don't play an instrument anymore, yes, I am a musician. I think that popular music, for the most part, is related pretty much to being young. I don't think it will last. I don't think 100 years from now people will be listening to the Rolling Stones. They might be listening to some of the Beatles music, which is wonderful. But for the most part, the groups today will be long gone and forgotten. Mozart, Mendelssohn, Schubert, Wagner, etc., 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 have already lived through their music for hundreds of years, and people will be listening hundreds of years from now because they tap into something sublime about the human condition. And the other thing that music does is it conquers time. It allows us, when we listen to that music, to be part of that individual's mind who lived centuries ago.
Yes.
And to communicate with them in a very, very special way. Literature does the same thing.
Yes.
But music for me does it in a very special way. Because I unite with the composer who lived decades, years ago.
The sound of the clock ends our interview. Great.